So welcome everybody. This is Jorge Gonzalez. I'm the director of the Biomed. We are a business association that promotes digital health across Europe and beyond. And we are very, very interested in digital transformation. So that's why we have created this series of events, of webinars, where we are bringing top-notch people across the world to talk about the digital transformation. Today, we have a great speaker, John Glaser from Harvard Medical School. John is also the leader of a course on digital transformation. And John is going to talk about how to lead digital transformation in healthcare for around 20, 25 minutes. And then we will have the chance to have a question and answers with him. John, we'd like to start very sharp on time. So the floor is yours. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation.
Sure, Jorge, and thank you for the invitation and my welcome to all of you. It's a pleasure to be with you. I am feeling particularly good today, not only because I have a chance to spend time with you all, but I became a grandfather for the fourth time yesterday, granddaughter who was born in the afternoon. So anyway, we're delighted to have a new addition to our family. So nonetheless, but anyway, let me talk about, we'll be spending time on leading digital transformation. You can see that in the slide. As Jorge mentioned, I'm an executive in residence at the Harvard Medical School. I have also spent 20 years as a chief information officer at a large health system in Boston with the Brigham and Women's Hospital, Mass General, and then 5 years running the healthcare IT business for Siemens, and then 5 years with Cerner running the population health business. So I've had exposure to both the provider side of digital transformation, but also to the vendor side of digital transformation. So, but let me begin with some overall comments. And the first is that obviously, I think all of us have seen in our lives the impact of digital transformation on a wide range of industries. So whether it's travel or financial services or buying goods and services, et cetera. And this has been particularly accelerated during the last year while we've all been quarantined to varying degrees here. So while we've seen digital transformation in many industries, we haven't seen as much in healthcare. And, you know, you can lots of reasons why that might be the case, but you could also argue that healthcare is perhaps poised to make the similar forward steps in digital transformation as we have seen in other industries. And that may be because of constant pressures on quality and cost and access, along with the accelerating effect of the pandemic. But nonetheless, if we are to prepare for a digital transformation in healthcare, one of the questions becomes, well, what can we learn from other industries? What have they taught us? Both taught us because at times it's been very successful. They've done, you've used some of these services to say, this is really well done, and I'm going to do my business with this organization because of this, but also because of their, at times, because they fail. And most people are people who study this, estimate about 70% of digital transformations fail. And the reason they fail, or what does failure look like? Well, failure looks like it cost much more than they thought. It took much longer than they thought. And the results were more disappointing than they had hoped for. So while it got done at a level, it failed in the sense of being on time, on budget, and delivering per expectations. So we can learn from failures just as we can learn from successes. So part of this is, and a lot of this talk here will be, what can we learn? Well, one of the things that we can learn is, well, what shapes the transformation? In other words, if I want to transform myself and I have this vision of what I will look like, how does that vision, which shapes that vision? What is that vision? How does it come to be? And the point here, and we see this across all industry, is the forces that shape the vision are, there are multiple forces. It's not only the organization's plans. It wants to be the low-cost provider of care, or it's got a vision of accelerating drug discovery, for example, but also government has an influence on the shape, because government has requirements both of funding, but also perhaps interoperability or privacy or services to be provided to the poor. But nonetheless, in addition to those forces, pandemics and crises shape the form of my transformation. So a lot of your transformations you're being considered now are reflective of the fact that we will soon be entering into a new normal after all the vaccinations and immunizations have been taken care of. But the crisis is not the only thing that shapes. The other is new technology. So a lot of transformations are shaped because an organization says, this is a new and exciting technology. It might enable us to do things we hadn't thought about doing before or gave up on doing. And so whether it's artificial intelligence, or it might be in a couple of years ago, the mobile device, given that we have a mobile device, it's networked and attached to the person and knows where they are, what can we do? Well, we could do ride sharing services that we can do. We can point out restaurants that are nearby them. And prior to that, it was the internet, which transformed retail. But the point is that one of the things that shapes your vision of yourself and your organization is examining new technologies that have arrived. And then the last point here is of the forces is new entrants. So new companies come into healthcare or into drug discovery, and they bring new ideas and new resources and new ways of doing things, and they shape what is being done because of that. So the point of all this kind of stuff is a couple points. One is, one of the things that we learn is that when you look at what is it that I want to what do I want to become when I'm done with my transformation? How does that get shaped? It is shaped by a series of forces, more than what you want to do, more than what the government, but you have to consider all of these forces together. And it's complicated to consider all of them together. Now, the other thing that it teaches us above and beyond that there are multiple forces is that these forces are changing all the time. I mean, new technologies come in all the time. Now, we don't get a pandemic all the time, but crises happen. You know, 2008, 2009 was the financial services crisis in most of the world, et cetera. So the other point about this is transformation actually never stops. You might think that you will be done someday, but you'll never be done. Partly because you wherever you are, you can always think of more things to do, but partly because these forces change all the time. So one is that the organization needs to get into this way of thinking that says transformation is important, but transformation also never stops. We must continue to transform all the time. So that's the first thing we learn from them. The next thing is when companies are asked, and this is a study that was done across industries, is where you're going to focus your transformation efforts in the next couple of years. This is what they see. So this is healthcare, this is life sciences, this is transportation, et cetera. You see in the first two that digitizing the end user experience, and this is often the customer, but in our case, it can be the physician or the nurse too. And partly this is a result of, you know, people having used more digital technologies in their daily lives because of the pandemic, that they become more used to these types of transactions and the bar is raised higher in terms of expectations of performance and ability. But nonetheless, there's going to be, and 37% say that's an area of focus for transformation. The other 63% still said it was very important, but I'm not sure they would have used the word transformation. The second is data and analytics. And a lot of what happened in the, as we companies looked at pandemics, is trying to figure out what's happening here. So for example, my daughter, my middle daughter, the one who became a new mom yesterday, runs the analytics group for a large chain of department stores in the United States. And they were looking at data when the pandemic hit, people stopped coming to the stores. But not all the same. In Florida, they actually had very little decrease in store attendance, but in California, significant drop in store attendance. And then the question becomes, well, when are they coming back? And what will they come back to buy? So looking at a lot of analytics and data to try to understand their business, what is going on and how do they thrive, et cetera. So we see that in healthcare is both the experience on our digital end user experience, but also on our sort of analytics activity, et cetera. We'll see some examples in a second here. So what we see is areas that are consistent across industry, which means that we will continue to learn from them. We can learn a lot from retail about how do you motivate, they try to motivate people to buy something. Well, we have the other example, how do you motivate people to manage their chronic disease? How do you manage people to do their rehab, motivate people to do their rehab if they've had surgery done, et cetera. And similarly on the analytics and the data side, it's capturing data from wearable devices or locations, et cetera. We can learn a lot from other industries. So one of the things you see across transformation efforts is healthcare's got its own set of unique aspects to it, but it's not so unique that they're totally different from what you see in other industries. So that's the first observation, a lot of commonality across industries. The second, you can see the middle three, it's number enhancing IT architecture, modernizing infrastructure and cybersecurity. Is when you transform, not only do people transform what they do relative to customers or what they do relative to the business, but they also transform their capabilities to transform. They say, listen, I want to be better at transforming. I have to be more capable. It's like training to run a race or a marathon, et cetera. You have to train yourself to be capable of running a marathon, et cetera. So one of the things they find in these pandemics, or I found in this recently here, is that they're not well equipped to take advantage of artificial intelligence. The analytics aren't very good. You're capturing data, the data quality is uneven, et cetera. You know, they're not able to do the same customer experience that you see in Apple or in Google, et cetera. So they're modernizing their architecture and their infrastructure, making the technology base more capable of doing the types of transformation activities they have both now, but as we remember, transformation never stops. So now and for the rest of time. They also found in the last three, redesigning the tech organization, redesigning the IT operating model, and changing IT's delivery model, is that in fact the IT organization often needed to be improved, that it wasn't as agile, that it wasn't as well integrated to the business as it should have been, that some of the talent levels were missing. Its ability to partner was not as good as it should be. So they're retooling the IT organization too, is transforming it. So the point of this slide is not only is there a lot of commonality to areas that are of interest across industries, which means we can learn from them. It also means that companies that make investments into the sort of analytics and tools that help you do, for example, robotic process automation, they see big markets, not just healthcare, but across all industries, which means there'll be a lot of investment and a lot of innovation in the technology going on there. So one is we see common elements, but also when you transform, it's not only what you're doing, but your ability to do it. And so this is often your IT organization and your infrastructure. Now, when we look at, here's just a couple of examples mentioned before of the impact of both the pandemic, but also consumer expectations and new entrants, et cetera. And an example of improving the customer experience. This is from the States. It's looking at US data, and it starts at zero. So the year zero is the first week of 2020 all the way through the end of 2020. So this is all of last year. You can see, and I'm sure you all saw this in the areas of the world that you live in and where your organizations thrive, is this huge jump in telehealth visits. And so this is a percent of all outpatient visits, all visits to the doctor's office, all visits to the emergency department, went from 0% fundamentally being telehealth to right now a stable number of about 8% telehealth. And it's been pretty stable. It's perhaps here to stay here. So there has been this transformation that is essentially moving us progressively or quickly away from brick and mortar care to virtual care. There's other aspects of that going on here. But nonetheless, this is an example both of that, of the sort of common element we share with other industries, but also clearly the impact of the pandemic. The other thing that's been clear, and this is the area of analytics, et cetera, is, and particularly, you know, saw this in the States, but you see this in other countries too. If you look at who died from COVID-19 or who wound up being hospital, it is disproportionately African-Americans and people of Hispanic heritage, et cetera, Latin heritage, et cetera. It's also people with physical, you know, obese or multiple chronic conditions. So if we're going to take care of people, we need better data, not only about what problems they have and what medications they're taking, what surgical procedures they have, but also about their social circumstances, their education, whether they are poor, whether they have the ability to get good food, nutritious food in the area that they live, whether the area is a crime-ridden area, et cetera, et cetera. So we'll see an expansion of analytics, not only above and beyond artificial intelligence, but an expansion of analytics to be a more holistic understanding of patients' data there. And so one of the things you see, and this is where we can learn from other industries, is the retail people in particular have an extraordinary ability to gather a lot of data about us. My daughter, for example, was telling us how they use data that they get from your mobile phones and where you move over the course of your data. So your mobile phones knows where you are, and it can track you over the course of a day, where you go. And they use that data to understand who comes to their stores, where do they go before they come to their stores, where do they go after they come to their stores, and try to understand you in a more holistic fashion here. So the point is, across the board, a greater expansion in the range of data as part of the transformation exercise here. So we learned that. So if we learn that there's multiple forces you have to understand, and those forces lead us to transformation never stops. And if we understand that a lot of sort of core focus on a couple of areas that cut across industries, but also not only areas that are important to us, but also our ability to do this, is the other thing that is learned here is that digital is the means, not the end. Sometimes we get all excited in this industry about the shiny object. You know, people go, oh my goodness gracious, I saw this really cool technology. It's artificial intelligence or it's wearable device. It measures this, it measures that. And that's all really cool, et cetera. but it's only important to the degree it helps you further an goal. Sometimes organizations get seduced by the technology, wind up implementing, but aren't really having thought through why. You know, why are we doing this? What do we hope to get out of it, et cetera? So we just have to remember that it is a way to accomplish something, but it is not the end. And the last point here is if our strategy is a terrible strategy or it's not really well thought out, it doesn't matter what technology we're going to bring in. We're going to screw it up. We will fail. So it cannot save us. It won't. If we have a bad strategy or we have incompetent people, the technology will not make those problems go away. We have to address those appropriately. Next point is a couple of points here about, okay, if I have my vision shaped by all these forces, and I understand the need and I have plans to do both outside, but also my ability to do this. And I appreciate that technology is valuable to greet help me further. What is it that I have to do? How do I execute well? Because mostly what you find when you look at the 70% failure rate, it's not necessarily because the plan was bad or the vision was bad. It's because they didn't execute it very well. I mean, they didn't do all the things that they needed to do and to do those well across the board. So there's lots of factors that say, am I set up to be successful? Are the success factors in place? Well, there's a couple of success factors. One of which is, do I have competent people? I mean, really good people. And sometimes you look across the table, you know, in an executive meeting and say, boy, we have some good people, but that person over there is just not very good. Well, that's going to hurt you. And not only do you have good people, but do they work well together? Are they a good team? A couple areas here that we're going to talk about is the process by which the organization arrives at the digital strategy. So if we look at the top bar, I'll read it to you. It says that business and IT digital strategies are co-created equally by the business and the IT department. So they come together to create this as a joint exercise. And then they iterate throughout the year. It's not just like they do it for 2 months and then they leave it alone for 10 months. They do it every month. Is this iterative ongoing process. And partly because the forces are changing, as we talked about, partly because as they execute it, they learn as well, that really worked pretty well. Or sometimes, as you all know, you try things and say, that didn't quite work as well as we thought. We have to alter it. We have to tune it. We have to change course a little bit, et cetera. So when you look over on the right, you see the top quartile performers. So those organizations that perform in the top 25% of their industry are compared to those that perform in the bottom 25% of the industry. And lots of ways to measure performance, you know, how much money they make, how market share they have. What you find is on the top quartile, 34% of the organizations who perform well have this co-creation of the IT strategy. But in the bottom, only 8% do that. And if you go all the way to the bottom, you say, well, there, the business and the IT digital strategies are developed independently of one another. There's no link between the two. And that means the organization wants to go to the right. The IT strategy is going to the left. And so they're not connected at all. And you find that in the top quartile, 3% of the organization say that characterizes us, but 22% in the bottom quartile. So the point is, above and beyond a factor like having good people who really work well together, and that seems trite, but at times it's not there, or it's not there as strongly as it should be, is how the strategy is brought. So one of the questions is, if I want to be successful, for example, I was talking to Jorge before we got on the phone call, what's the roadmap? Well, part of the roadmap is, and above and beyond the specific of what I do I have the right strategy development process? Do I exhibit the behavior that's at the top one here, where these teams work well together to co-create and revisit it routinely? And if not, I had better put that in place before I get too excited about creating a digital transformation strategy, because I'm likely to fail if I don't have this process in place. So that's one example. The next one is on the change management. You know, fundamentally, if you say, all right, I have a strategy, I think I know what I want to be in terms of being a terrific patient experience, or, you know, really managing the cost of care, et cetera. And I've done a pretty good job of looking at the technology and say, can artificial intelligence really help me here? Or if so, how? Or can mobile devices really help me here? Or and if so, how? Maybe not, but can they? So I've done a nice job of visioning my future and really reviewing the technology and how the two come together here. And I've also done a nice job of bringing together the IT people and the business people to co-create this. Is now I have to change, manage change, because a lot of digital transformation, frankly, is change management. You know, and change management we've been doing for a long time across businesses and organizations. It happens to have a digital focus now, but at the end of the day, it's still change management, et cetera. Kind of reminds me, and sort of start becoming a grandfather for the fourth time, I think my kids raising their kids will have the same challenges that I had raising them. And that is, how do you deal with a teenage daughter, you know, who does or doesn't understand what you're trying to talk about? That's the problem I had and the problem they will have too, as we go through. So a lot of this has been, is sort of old challenges, and doesn't mean they're trivial, but been with us for a while here. So one of the things we make about this sort of change management, one is, we've talked about, it never ends, because there's always a, you know, our bar gets raised and the world changes, et cetera. The other key point here is that it's incremental. So when you see successful organizations transform, what they do is they take a step and then they assess. How well did that work? What do we have to do? And then they take another step and assess. And then they take another step and assess. And then they take another step and assess. In fact, transformation looks like this never-ending series of medium-sized steps and assessments. What you don't see is, or see success, is this big leap where you, one day you went from, you know, nothing to another day where you took a big leap forward, et cetera. Usually that doesn't happen. Now, why doesn't that happen? One is because it's highly risky to do that. There's a saying in the industry, how does projects sometimes blow up or transformations fail? And one colleague I talked to said it's death by ants. No single bite will kill you, but 1,000 will. In other words, you take too big of a leap and lots of things go wrong, too many things go wrong, and you collapse. Whereas if you take a step, things will go wrong, no question, but they're more manageable. You can address them and then you can take the next step. One thought about here, and I think, you know, Amazon, for example, and I don't know whether Amazon's present in all your countries, but it's basically, you know, a large retailer, accounts for 50% of the e-commerce volume in the US. Anyway, if you look at in the US last year, what percent of all retail sales were done over e-commerce versus somebody walking in the store? Now, this is during the pandemic era, so everybody's quarantined now, but what percent? And the answer is 17%. So in 83% of the time, people went to the store to buy something. 70% of the time, they bought it over the internet, et cetera. Say, wow, I would have thought it's larger, but it's 17%. Now, part of the reason is people don't buy gasoline for their cars over the internet. And you say, well, that being aside, when was Amazon formed? And the answer is 1994. So in 27 years, we've gone from 0% to 17%. Now, that's still a transformed industry, but it took one step at a time. First books, and then digital electronic, and then this, and then that. Step by step, they became the dominant force in retail consumer. So point is, a step assess. And the reason you do that, and the reason that that's successful, is it reduces the risk that you of sort of jumping prematurely into a future you don't really understand. You know, you might think you know what this vision, how it really works, but you really don't. And particularly if it's transformative, it's really different, or should be, from what you're used to. You just don't understand it very well. It's like when you're, you know, getting married in your 20s. Do you really understand what retirement looks like? No, not at all. You know, you can't. It's just too far away from you. It also enables you to learn what works and what doesn't. So we'll try this. We think we're really smart, but it turns out we were smart 4 times out of 5, but not 5 times out of 5. It also helps staff who are trying to do their job today. You know, still got work to do, but also transform at the same time is to make it a more manageable process for them, a less stressful or stress-reduced process for them, et cetera. And by the fact that it's step assess, step assess, step assess, reinforces this message that it never ends. So two practices, and there are others, and perhaps we could talk about those in the QA, that help improve success. One is that there's this tight linkage between the business and the IT, iterative tight linkage. The second is a transformation is a step assess approach to managing change. So just a quick plug, and Jorge's been through this. Some of you might be through this. This program we have at the medical school, I won't spend any real time at this other than to point out 2 weeks virtual, and use of the material that we cover both change management, but also technologies such as artificial intelligence and telehealth. What do we learn from other industries? What do we think the tech giants' roles of Google and Apple and Microsoft, what roles do they have here, et cetera? And then also as a case study is, if you were being asked to lead a transformation to improve the engagement of patients in managing the health, how would you go through that? So anyway, I will leave this to you. I will get a copy of the slides off to you. So if you decide that you want to look at this in more detail, there we go. And this also has the URL, but also the dates at which this is occurring. We have, see this May 31st through June 11th, we have a special session for our colleagues in Latin America. But nonetheless, if you decide that this is of interest, let us know. Be happy to have you. So that's the comments that I have. We'll open it up for questions. I'm going to end the presentation so maybe I could see you all. Let's see if I can get into the stop share here.
I don't think you can see them.
Okay.
You can see the names if you see the, and you click on participants. But, okay. We don't, in this setting of Zoom, we don't see each other, but I'm sure that people will also have questions, and we are eager to get them in the question and answer section in Zoom. If you mouse over the bottom part of your screen, you will see the menu. There is a chat that is more for communication about that, but there's a question and answer. Well, thank you very much, John, for your presentation. Till we get the first questions, there is one question that's in the chat, but anyway, Jordi asks, how do we manage primary care in the digitalization? John?
Yeah, I think the primary care is, there's a number of aspects to it in the efforts to digitize, you know, one of which is to, if the primary care doctor, your primary care doctor, is the person who is responsible for managing all of your care, including when you see a specialist like an endocrinologist, or perhaps you have a cardiovascular issue, so you're seeing a cardiologist, is to improve their ability to get the data about what's going on here. One of the things we find in the States is a third of the time the doctor will not know that you were seen in the emergency room or that you were discharged from the hospital. They just don't know what's going on here. So there's multiple approaches to primary care. One is improving the interoperability and sharing of data. Now this is hard and takes time, et cetera. The second is to give you analytics that say, here's, you know, where your, here's the aggregate picture of your patients, their care and their costs, and here's your diabetic population, how many of them are managing their diabetes well versus not well, et cetera. So just to give you the ability to know at a snapshot level, you know, of all the patients you're responsible, how well are they doing across the board here? And also to link that into your electronic health record, which would be the third thing. So that if, when I am being seen by you, you say, by the way, John, we need to give you a shot, a shingles shot, or by the way, you need to lose weight because I'm looking at this, and sort of the, what we call gaps in care. So for primary care, it's both the interoperability so that you know what's going on. It's the data to help you see that holistically. It's also the ability in your electronic health record to see what are the next steps that need to be taken care of. Now, in addition to that, what's been primary care has had to confront relatively recently is obviously telehealth. It's like, geez, you know, one out of 10 visits will now be telehealth. How do I fit that into my practice? You know, what is the, you know, how do we handle waiting rooms and check-in? Should I do all of my telehealth visits in a, you know, one after another in an afternoon, or sort of sprinkle them between in-person visits and telehealth visits? So a lot of clinical workflows. There's also a lot of discussion about, well, what are the right clinical protocols? You know, for example, there's a lot of post-operative care you can do through telehealth. You know, show me your wound, raise your arm so I could see whether the shoulder surgery worked or didn't work. But nonetheless, we have to get better clinical protocols that are out there so the care is safe and appropriate that's going on here, et cetera. And then last point on sort of primary care that is occurring here is the increasing role, it's still early, what I call digital therapeutics, where the therapy for you is actually an app. Where you see this most often is in mental health for, you know, insomnia or for stress, you know, or for depression, where, you know, you're seeing less of a mental health professional and more of an app that you have here. So I think there's a sort of one of the things you see in primary care is the normal face-to-face, which has been the bedrock or foundation. A good portion of that, and I think it's still early, it becomes virtual, and whether it's through telehealth or an app that is going through here. But anyway, a lot of primary care is in the verge of seeing a lot of changes and going through here and a lot of transformation potential. Now, remember, these changes take a long time, so I think this will take place over years. But nonetheless, I suspect that if we were to have this conversation 5 years from now, 10 years from now, we would be impressed by the changes that are occurring in primary care.
Thank you very much, John. We have a couple of questions in the Q&A. Well, the first one is from Carlos and it's more a comment, but I don't know if you want to extend what Carlos is saying about that. I still don't understand why healthcare goes at the bottom of the whole industries regarding digital transformation, because as you say, it's a never-ending process. So sooner or later, we will have to attend it. I don't know if you want to extend this comment.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the questions is, well, why is healthcare behind? You know, why is it, you know, down to the far left, whereas retail is off to the far right, et cetera. You know, it's supposed to be very bright people. It's not because they're a bunch of dummy people here. They're very smart with the medical school and all that kind of stuff. And they're really pressing issues, you know, that occur because of, you know, cost and quality, et cetera. And I think there's a number of things. One is healthcare tends to be more conservative. You know, healthcare is based on these, you know, we talk about it on other issues where you can fail fast. Say, yeah, but I want to be careful about failing in healthcare because that can hurt people. So we can tend to be more conservative in some about it, because failure means different things in some way. And often what you see in healthcare is the base of science. So you read the medical journals about studying and is this drug effective? You know, so a lot of the vaccine discussion, is it effective or not? And people want good science because they don't want to get hurt by this stuff. And the regulators want good science. But there's nothing like that in retail. Retail doesn't study in a scientific way to the same degree that healthcare does, or transportation, et cetera, which means they move faster. You know, they are much more willing to take a couple of example experiences and do something at scale, rather than healthcare might say, well, we're going to study it, you know, make sure there's really a good statistical differences here, et cetera. The other is that at times, depending on what healthcare, you know, environment system you're in, is where the reimbursement doesn't really reward efficiency or being innovative. You know, in the States, you know, you're reimbursed largely for volume. Well, shoot, there's no extra money coming in if you're efficient or high quality. There is extra money if you see a lot of people, et cetera. So the motivational structure is not always the same that is going on here. And then last point, I'll point out, and there's, you go on for a long time, is that most healthcare is mission-driven, which means we're worried about not only care and, you know, being financially okay, but we're worried about the health of our community, and we're worried about educating the next generation of clinicians, et cetera. We're worried about research and solving diseases, et cetera. So that makes the sort of value proposition a little bit more complicated than investing in IT. Is this very complex value proposition that go through there. So anyway, I think there's a number of factors which make healthcare slower and harder. I do, as a final comment, is that's true in any time you get a social economic good, where you're not only the economics at work, you know, people worry about losing money and this, that, and the other, but also there's a social and important social role. It tends not to move as fast. So the other area where you see this is education. Education, similar, does not move as fast on IT as you will see in some of these other industries, because it too is an economic good, but it's also a social good. We all worry about our educating our children and making sure that we educate those who are disadvantaged so that they get out of poverty, for example. So I think there's a bunch of reasons for that. They're hard reasons. It just means we have more work to do and it will take us longer.
All right, thank you very much. There is a question from Ioannis that asks, how digital transformation in healthcare could be affected by ethics and data protection regulations?
Well, I think this is there's a fair question. The data protections that you see in retail are a lot looser than what you see in healthcare. Now, it varies by country. And, you know, the European Union has, the more stringent privacy laws. But even in the States, some states have different privacy laws. But nonetheless, a lot of the protections that apply to healthcare data do not always apply to, you know, some of the other industries. So I do think we have to worry more about healthcare. I mean, the consequences of data disclosure in healthcare are more significant than if people find out that you buy, you know, some unusual item from time to time. You can lose your job. You can lose insurance. You can be publicly embarrassed because of discovery of, you know, this disease or whatever behaviors you have, et cetera. So I think we are going to be hindered by it, but that's a societal call. And society decides that this is the type of protection we want to see surrounding my health data and your health data. And in a way, society says, we accept the consequences. You know, we accept that this might slow down research. We accept the consequences. This might slow down certain types of innovation. So we do that. We also do have ethical issues. And, you know, I'm worried about always ethical issues of, you know, right to die. You know, when is the time when I say I'm ready to die because I have a terrible disease and I'm in pain and it's not going to get cured, et cetera. But it's not the only ethical issue. You know, I'll give you an example, and this is where we get confronted in artificial intelligence. So a particular algorithm in the US was developed to use machine learning to identify patients who were, sort of needed additional care focus. And the way that it looked at of 100 people who I should pay attention to, which are the five who are the most important. And it looked at it in terms of cost. You know, I'm going to pay attention to those who are the most expensive because those are the ones who presumably are the sickest, et cetera. And so it ran that algorithm and it realized that it had made a mistake. And the mistake that it made is in a number of cases, you have very poor people who are very sick, but don't cost very much. Why? Because they don't seek care. They can't afford to. So their costs are low, even though they're very sick. So here was a bias in an algorithm, a machine learning algorithm that had ethical problems, because ethically, it meant that those who we have made a social social commitment to take care of, we did not take care of it. That wasn't intentional, it was inadvertent. But anyway, we do have, we'll see in AI, some ethical quandaries raised because the machine learning algorithms are wrong or off by certain things and create disparities that, you know, already existed, just make them worse. So we have, and this goes back to the social economic good. There's this, all industries have a social issue. I mean, they're all interested in climate change to varying degrees, et cetera, but it's more pronounced and it's more significant in healthcare. And that will hinder us to a degree, but we accept that. As a society, we come to say, we, you know, whatever, accept that balance.
Right. Now we have a kind of long question from GP Manzano that asks about the cost of digitalization. I mean, especially the cost of when should we invest? Does it make sense to invest when technology goes so quickly or advance so quickly that it makes the investment obsolete in a number of years? Does it make sense to do such a big investment in public systems like the Spanish ones, he says? Any comments on this, John?
Yeah, I think, you know, the I think cost is complicated in a number of reasons. Sometimes because particularly in, you know, like the Spanish health system, you know, where it's government funded and the government has to think about abroad how much money it has and how much will the taxpayers do. So, you know, there's always sort of cost constraints in lots of ways here. It gets also harder on the cost things where you can say, I'm willing to expand where there's, quote, a good return on my investment. So I'll spend money if I know I'm going to save money. I can do the, quote, ROI. But if I reduce medication errors, how much is that worth to me? If I improve decision-making, how much is that worth to me? If I reduce pain, how much is that worth to me? So you can have, in healthcare and in other industries too, really complicated cost discussions because in the ratio, the numerator on the top, it's just either you can't measure it. You know, what's improved decision making? How do you measure improved decision making, et cetera? And so, or you can measure it, but it, you know, you're not sure whether should I spend twice as much to reduce medication errors by twice as much or what? So it's a very complicated conversation to get that right. That being said, I think is the other question is, you know, is you know, how much should we spend? And particularly, if there's an obsolescence question. I think that's fair. And that's one of the challenges. I do think when you get into incrementalism, I'm willing to invest X, and then I'm willing to invest another X, and then I'm willing to invest a little bit more X. So I'm going to take the, I may have to size up the aggregate investments. It's really big, but I'm going to take it bite size at a time, just to make sure, first of all, I'm getting my return, that type of return here. But the others, to the degree that new technology comes in and replaces what I have here, then I have the ability to do this stuff. At times, I think we are too quick to go to the new technology. So I'll give you an example. You know, years ago, I remember buying shirts over the internet for the first time. And I thought, wow, this is a terrific experience to do this. And what's the technology behind it? It was this old creaky mini computer that was still chugging along here. So you can do pretty good work with older technology. And I always think at times that you want to wait until the technology maturity is a little further along so you know that it can be supported, it's mature, et cetera, et cetera. So at times we replace too quickly. You know, we're sort of fall in love with the latest generation. I think we could skip sometimes the generations of technology, unless it's really compelling that the difference is there. That being said, it's still complicated. One, it's a lot of money, no question about it. The second is the return is often intangible or difficult to measure. So it becomes hard to defend relative to other investments that a, you know, a country might be made, et cetera. So I don't think there's a great answer to this other than you work hard at trying to get the right balance across the board here. It's, you know, similarly, how much should I pay people who work for me? It becomes hard to know exactly what the right amount is. When will they leave versus when am I overpaying them?
Right. Angelica has a question about the artificial intelligence being used at the point of care. And she says, how do you believe it will disrupt medical doctors' jobs in the next decade?
Yeah, I don't think there'll be the, I mean, it depends what you think what disruption means. There's been some discussion, geez, well, we need doctors, you know, we'll just have all these machines doing all this stuff. I doubt that that will happen to any degree, et cetera. You know, what you see in artificial intelligence is really two targeted areas. One is robotic process automation. So we use the AI to automate a process and a process of determining whether you should still be in the hospital or not in the hospital. Or the process of having, you know, a nurse who works part-time find the right shift for him or her. So, but we're automating a process, you know, often administrative process. The other is augmenting decision-making. So it may be, and you see a lot of work now, in the AI sort of reading an image and saying, by the way, there might be a tumor here, but I'm augmenting the decision of the radiologist to go off and do this. So I think that we'll see a lot of augmentation. So if you're the doc and you're sitting in front of a physician sitting in front of the screen, you may see, and we'll see, examples where the machine comes up and says, I think you might want to consider doing the following. because it looks like the following test should be run, or it looks like the following medications ought to be prescribed. In a way, it'll be like the decision support we've already had. It just becomes more targeted, perhaps more sophisticated. So we'll see that. The other part where I think you'll see artificial intelligence as a physician is what we call contextual awareness. In other words, you walk up to the screen and type your password, your name and your user ID and password, and the machine says, I know who you are. I also know you're looking at Mrs. Smith. And I know from the EHR, Mrs. Smith has the following conditions and is taking the following care treatments, et cetera. I know what the evidence says, and I know what her preferences are. And based on all of that, I'm going to shape the information that you see. I'm going to select pieces of data that I think are probably most likely to be important to you. And I'm going to put forward in front of you actions I think you're most likely to take or want to take, et cetera. So I think you're going to want to pay attention to this set of data, and you're likely to want to make these test orders. It's contextually aware. It's aware of the context of you, the patient, the care that they're receiving. Now you see early forms of this in retail, where I, depending on the retail site that you use, where the retail e-commerce site will come back and say, while you're buying this, you might want to consider these other things. Or people like you bought these other things here. It is aware of the context. It sees your pattern of ordering, sees other people like you, and is trying to, you know, help, you know, increase the amount that you buy, which is what they want to do here, et cetera. So we'll see increasingly contextual awareness. So anyway, I don't think docs will get replaced any material degree. I do think there'll be augmented or decision making, where they sort of, here, you might want to think about this. And I think the systems will begin to be shape themselves to this particular situation.
And let's not forget that it's almost in every country there's planned that there's going to be a shortage of doctors.
Yes.
Anyway, so we need to enhance their work with tools, with the, likely technology, but yeah, they. But anything that is new, I think, frightens people all over. That's a growth in history. There is another question for Jordi that says, and here again comes artificial intelligence. Regarding possibilities of artificial intelligence and algorithms to demonstrate efficacy, safety, effectiveness of medicines or treatments, what happens if the evidence generated by these algorithms contradicts the current evidence available that has been generated by, say, clinical trials?
Yeah, I think a couple of things here. One is one of the discussions and examinations that is going on is that, you know, one of the ways that you get the algorithm is you go through the real world evidence, sort of the, you know, what people talk about. So I want to go through, remember when I was at Partners Healthcare, we were going through the data, the admissions to the emergency room at the Brigham and Women's Hospital, Massachusetts General Hospital, and you could see the Vioxx signal. You could see the increase in heart attacks occur and extend over a 4-year period of time. So the point is you can use the machine learning to say there's a pattern in here that suggests this is the right evidence, you know, and I appreciate all the studies, but nonetheless, here's this pattern that you might want to look at. So I suspect increasingly we will use the machine algorithms to actually create the evidence that's got to go on here. On the flip side, often what they do is to say, all right, I already have the evidence. I'm going to create my algorithm. I'm going to use the evidence to test it to see whether or not, you know, the machine algorithm is working correctly. You know, one of the advantages that the machines have, well, they have to be careful. And I was talking to a colleague about this. He said, you know, if you ran machine learning this time last year over COVID patients and said, what's the right way to take care of them and who's at risk of dying and who's at risk of going to the hospital, whatever algorithm you had, if you ran it again today, you'd be wrong because the disease has shifted and there's been immunizations along the way and we've learned how to treat them, et cetera. So one of the things that you can do with machine learning algorithms, which are continuous learning, is you can evolve as the evidence evolves. It evolves as the situation evolves, where sometimes in a published study, it just takes too long. You know, by the time you do the study, you get it peer reviewed, you put it out there, et cetera, a couple of years have gone by and the world has changed on you. So I think, you know, machine learning will, you know, to the degree the clinical trial with a hypothesis and control groups is still the gold standard. We're not quite there in terms of being replaced by, you know, AI, but AI can be the generator of evidence. AI can be, you can use the evidence to test AI, and AI can be perhaps, you know, better at evolving as the evidence evolves and making it more up to date in lots of ways.
Thank you very much, John. There's a question by Jose Luis Morentia that says that, is it possible that we are too focused on pure medical issues when other actors like, for example, keeping the patient active, self-care, physiotherapy.
Yes.
They have shown also an important economic impact. Perhaps now they are being neglected because of this shiny object as general that is digital.
I think that's a terrific point. I mean, we are, you know, we forget that, you know, while as important as medical care is, you know, and if any of us have, you know, serious cardiac issue or cancer, we want the best medical care we have. And that's important that we get that. It's not as important to the health of a population as whether the population manages their weight, whether their blood pressure is under control, whether they smoke or they don't smoke, whether they take 10,000 steps a day. So I think, you know, and similarly, if you look at, it goes back to the one of the slides, it turns out that one of the greatest predictors of health in the United States is your zip code. Where do you live? You know, if you live in an area where there are, you can't get good food, if you live in an area where you can't really walk outside because of, you know, crime or dogs without leashes or whatever, if you can't get transportation. So it's poverty and being disadvantaged has enormous impact on these things. So I think, you know, frankly, if you had, a money to spend, you say, I'd probably be better off in many cases spending that money on helping people manage their blood pressure, frankly, than I would be on improving survivability of a particular form of cancer. So I think we do. There's a lot of activity of the sort of digital health on helping you, you know, use wearable technologies. And some of them are, above and beyond step counts and blood pressure counts. And now you can take an EKG. You know, Fitbit, for example, is working on an algorithm if you have ulcerative colitis or Crohn's disease. And those of you familiar with the disease know that you can have a flare, which means all of a sudden you have to go to the bathroom all the time, is that it can predict that you'll get a flare within 30 minutes, which is, you know, an enormously important to folks like that managing chronic disease. So I think there's a lot of interest in digital activity. There's challenges of who pays for it. There's challenges of people use it and then stop using it, 6 months later, et cetera. So how do you motivate behavior change and things like that? But long way of saying, I think there is, first of all, that's a much, it's a terribly important area of health and healthcare is managing those things. It is an area of interest to the digital technology folks, but they're still facing challenges, not only with data privacy, but also payment.
Right. We have another question from Johannes that says, basically technology is here, wearables, devices, etc. I think you have mentioned those, but maybe you can expand a little bit more, John, about that. What are the obstacles? So if we have the technology and there is kind of a will to use it, what are the obstacles and how we can enhance the development and innovative work to digital transform healthcare systems?
Yeah, fair enough. I think there's several obstacles. Sometimes the obstacle is cost. So if you're poor, you say, I can't afford to pay for whatever the technology, the wearable, the Fitbit watch or whatever, I just can't afford it. So there's clearly an affordability issue that can be in place here. So that's part of it here too. The other is, and I remember, a couple of years ago, I volunteered to be a human subject in a clinical study at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston here. And it was basically, is how do you persuade people who are healthy to adopt healthier behaviors? And so I said, I'll do that, I'm pretty healthy. And what were the four behaviors I had to adopt? One is I had to eat a multivitamin a day, which I thought, well, that's easy to do. The second, 3 or fewer servings of red meat a week. I said, well, I wasn't doing that, but I could do that. The third is to 5 to 7 servings of fruit or vegetables a day. And I thought, well, that's a lot. That's a lot of bananas, but I'm not sure I can do it. And the fourth was 10,000 steps a day. Now, those are the four behaviors, et cetera. Now, there are other behaviors. But you look at those behaviors and say, actually, it's not all that much digital here. You record what you did. And I would record this on a website. And if I miss my goal, I got a call from Maria, the health coach, who, had no sense of humor. I remember I was raised by nuns in grammar school, and they had no sense of humor either. And I remember actually sort of side note asking Maria, she said, you're not doing very well with your fruits or vegetables. And I said, I know, I just can't eat that many bananas in the course of a day, she said. And I said, well, do onion rings count? She said, no, they don't. And I said, well, coffee grows in the ground. A cup of coffee's got to be a vegetable. So no, it's not. I know. All right. Help me out here. So the point being is that those I thought about, and I got the regime down. I learned how to do this. And I thought about a couple of things. Why did I do this? Why did I change my behavior? I didn't have to. There's not like I had a heart attack or, golly, I'm not going to be able to live to see my grandkids get married or whatever it is. One is because there was good data that suggests the data on walking is really quite powerful. It just reduces all kinds of risks. Wow, there's pretty good data. The second, there was lots of practical help from Maria. It's sort of, no sense of humor, but she was quite practical. So she said, listen, if you can't eat that many bananas, there are certain fruit drinks where you can get 2 servings of this. And I said, oh, that's a great idea. So anyway, very practical help that went on. The third is I had some data on feedback, and I'm the type of person, you all may be too, where nobody else is really watching the goal, but you know, if I say, golly, I missed the goal, I'm gonna strive to get this, sort of the data feedback loop. And the other is I had a little bit of technology here. So what struck me is I needed all that. I needed to know why, I needed some practical helps, I needed some data on feedback, and I needed a little bit of technology. But frankly, the technology was the least important part of this thing. You know, it had to be there, but it was not nearly as important, frankly, as Maria calling, or not nearly as important as the data. So I think we can use wearables to help. We have to remember that they may be the least important part of the conversation. Is what motivates you to do that? Who helps you, you know, in terms of looking at, say, I got to lose weight, but, you know, how do I sort of size up a meal in terms of calories and things like that? And so it is a series of things that have to come together. But even there, it's kind of hit or miss problems. One last comment, and then I was talking to one of my students a couple of years ago, and he had started a company to help middle-aged men who had had a heart attack perform their rehabilitation, you know, get their heart muscle back to being strong as it was, et cetera. And one of the things he found is that half the men didn't do it. I said, oh my goodness gracious, you know, about as scary an event as you can imagine, a heart attack. And yet, you know, a month later, you're not doing the walking or whatever it is you're supposed to do. So he developed this technology that sort of measured your heart function, measured where you took steps, all this kind of stuff to say, are you modifying your behavior to do your cardiac rehab? It would transmit that into a care team that would look at it and, you know, say, oh, you're doing well or not so well. And I said, well, how did it work? And how was the technology? He said, well, the technology worked fine. But he said, more important than the technology was the degree to which you, the patient, felt that the care team cared about you. In other words, someone at the other end reached out and said, John, great job, buddy. You've been doing all your steps. Or John, we're worried about you picking up weight. I worry about you. Somebody cared about me. Sort of patient care is going on here. So anyway, a long way of saying, I think it will be important. But have to remember, it is the other, you know, less technical. It's people caring. It's advice. It's the literature, maybe more important than whatever it is you strapped yourself.
Right. Technology should be invisible, in my view. It's mm-hmm. not the important thing. It's what is behind it. Most of the people that I think that are in this talk say that they are believers and entrepreneurs, but they don't have leading positions in their organizations. They are not the CEO, they are not medical directors, but they still want to trigger change. What would you advise them? Say, yeah, I believe in that. I think that transformation for good, leveraging digital is something that should be done in my organization, but I don't have the power. What would you tell them?
Well, I think a couple of things. One is, you know, to the degree that the leadership says, here's our goals and our strategies. And so you understand, is that there? You know, what is it the organization wants to do and accomplish? So
in my experience, unfortunately, we don't have so many organizations with that clear strategy. They just live day by day reading the newspapers.
Yeah, fair enough.
That there is no fire with them. But anyway.
Well, part of it, and you know, it depends on this in the situation, you know, because sometimes you say, I don't know what to do. You can say, listen, I need to have, if I were to show up with an idea, that they would pay attention. Now, the reason they might pay attention is one is because there's a goal that they have that I can say, I can help you achieve that goal. Oh, that's great. Or there's a fire. There's something that's, you know, there's on fire, something's screwed up, you know, and people are mad and whatever. I can help you make sure that doesn't happen again. But the point is, you find based on what is going on in the organization, something that will motivate them to at least listen to me, et cetera. So one is, well, what is that? And so I would do that. The second is that, you know, part of it is your credibility. So if you walk into that meeting or room here, they say, I know of this person is good, or they don't. But last thing you want to do is walk in and say, this person is an idiot. They won't listen to you at all, et cetera. So part of it is whether you have credibility, or you can get an ally who's got credibility here. The thing I would avoid doing is using the word transform. Because basically it's, oh my goodness gracious, that sounds way too grandiose, way too ambitious, we'll never get it done, cost it damn much, you know, get out of here, but, you know, go away. What you can say, if you have a problem or an issue, we can do this to help. In other words, I said, that's a bite-sized step. I think I can afford that. I think I can try it. I think the other thing you do is let's pilot it. So we're not committing anything. All right, I'm all for piloting, you know, et cetera. So it goes step by step. Don't try to go for the big leap because they're not ready for that. They may think it's buzzword or jargon or, you know, whatever. You don't get it, the hard reality of it. Is there a targeted opportunity which you can take a step this big? And if you take a step this big and it works, I take the next step. and then the next step. And in a way, transformation at times, particularly when you have a leadership that this is not really receptive, is stealth. It is, you know, is sneaky at a level that you go off and do that. So, and I think that is, you know, one of the things I think is really important in these things is do what I call political reconnaissance. Which, in other words, who are the important people in the organization? And they know who, you know who they are. The other is what motivates them? You know, how would I persuade this important person or this important person or this important person? You know, what motivates them to do it? What language do they speak? The finance guy speaks a finance language. The, you know, the chief medical officer speaks another language, et cetera. So if I know who they are and I know how they motivate, can I package what I'm trying to do in a language that, first of all, they understand? And then a language that resonates with them in terms of value. And, you know, again, avoid the technology stuff because they don't get the technology. It makes it look like, oh, my, it goes back to the comments, something that's really expensive. You know, it doesn't really work very well. But anyway, a long way of saying, you know, either with an opportunity or a crisis or a problem, et cetera, is doing the reconnaissance. Can I package it in a step this big and avoid the jargon words, you know, the transformation that's got to go on here, et cetera, because that'll just, that'll alienate them.
Right. Understood. So what? If I take something from this, go, let's go step after step. I think that's a good message has been come across. John, thank you very much. I know that you have to leave early, so I think it's a very good point to leave the conversation. Thank you very much for inspiring us. And please, if I were you, I mean, I took the course, John's course, and I highly recommended it. It is, you can find more information in our website. In any case, I just want, there is a, let me see, there's a last, okay, that's a thank you from you. There have been a number of thank yous, John, for the answer.
Oh, thank you, yes, thank you.
For the sake of time, I didn't answer them. And I just want to invite everybody next week at the same time, on the same day, we are going to have the Ministry of Turkey that I was amazed by the patient portal and the technology they have for managing clinical data. That was 4 years ago, and I'm very curious to see how it's working today. So I strongly recommend you to attend if you want to understand better how to interact and engage with patients. That would be, you just need to register again for next Thursday. And John, again, thank you very much. I don't know if you want to say any closing remark or anything before we leave.
No, thank you all. I appreciate you taking time to listen. I hope the comments were helpful. And I look forward to staying in touch. It sounds like, Jorge, you put together a terrific lineup of speakers. And I look forward to being able to listen to some of the sessions.
Fantastic. In case you can, you or any of the audience, you know that we record it. We will be sharing the recording and the presentation in some days. And yeah, please stay with us if you want to know more about digital transformation, about the world. Okay.
Terrific.
We are here to help. Okay.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Take care.
Bye. Bye.